This motherboard right here is the ASRock X570S Phantom Gaming Riptide. Now this board is coming in at around $180 MSRP, and it's a refresh. Essentially, what's ASRock doing releasing a motherboard all this time after Zen 2 boards were launched and the original X570 motherboards were launched back in 2019? And you may be wondering, is there any difference between an X570S, for example, or maybe you see another board called an X570P or an X570X, and you may be wondering, is there any differences between these boards and the ones that were released nearly 2 years ago? And to answer that question directly, I actually went and asked AMD, and I said, AMD, is there any real functional differences at the chipset level that would make someone want to, say, if they had an X570 motherboard, go out and buy an X570S? And their reply was, well, you're getting the same X570 chipset, it's just that the motherboard partners like ASRock, MSI, ASUS, and Gigabyte, they've all decided to go and refresh these boards and add these affixiations on, which in different cases may mean different things. Now, in the case of the X570S from ASRock, the S essentially means silent. So the only difference between this and, say, original X570 that was released back in 2019 would be that this has no chipset heatsink fan, so it's going to be silent, and the S stands for silent. And then you may be thinking, well, if you take the fan away, is that going to cause heating issues? And here's where we're going to do the full review of this motherboard right after that Tech Yes City intro. So let's get it on and go through all the paces of this board to see if it does represent value at $180. So taking away that chipset heatsink fan, is that going to make a difference to temperatures? And here's where out of the box, we got 60 degrees idling. And then when we decided to run a stress test with the graphics card ramped up to full, and then also run the M.2 slot at the same time, this is where we again saw really no negligible difference in temperatures increasing. And now this probably has to do with the fact that the PCIe 4.0 lanes are running from the CPU. And of course you can get and extract performance out of the chipset's own PCIe 4.0 lanes if you want to, but loading up a graphics card in the bottom X4 slot is really pointless. It's just gonna add in a little bit of extra latency and you're gonna get worse performance. So I don't know anyone who would ideally want to do this. Though that said, 60 degrees is a fine number in a 25C environment, considering these chipset hubs are rated to go up to 90 degrees, and sometimes they were even sitting around 80 degrees when I was first testing out the X570 itself back when I was doing the reviews in 2019. So it seems like ASRock have tuned this thing up absolutely fine. But going over another very important part with the motherboard is, of course, the VRM. Now here's where we got a 5950X. We overclocked this to 4.4 gigahertz all cores on 16 cores, 32 threads. So this 10-phase VRM ASRock's implemented could handle the 5950X overclocked absolutely fine, with temperatures going around 73 degrees max in a 25C ambient environment, as well as the heatsink going into the mid 40s. Now I do like to run this test for roughly 20 minutes, and that will weed out any inefficiencies in the VRM, especially when it's overclocked. So if it does fail this, or the VRM temperatures get too high, then that's a motherboard that you would want to avoid, at least if you're going with higher end CPUs, and especially if you are overclocking them. Now the X570S Riptide here has a 10-phase VRM with 60 amp chokes and also 50 amp MOSFETs, and this did the job absolutely fine, where we saw a maximum temperature of 73 degrees and then 46 degrees on the heatsink. And then also out of the box, it took the 5950X to 3.85 gigahertz, and here's where you're gonna draw roughly 130 watts direct draw, and then from the wall, 230 watts. And I'll also show you the idle power consumption numbers too, for those people who want to go AFK in between working or in between gaming sessions. And also one thing that I like to do is to test the overclock numbers versus the stock numbers, because that will also see how well the VRM scales, which is one thing that I have noticed that some mid-range and low-end boards do very poorly in the past. However, in case of the Riptide, it's coming in with a very good performance figure here, on top of the fact that it's got an 8-layer PCB. In the case when we looked at the RAM, where I locked in a 3600 megahertz XMP profile with 1T, 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 this locked it in first go. There was absolutely no problems. And this is great if you want to play games with some of the best FPS, especially out of the box without having to waste too much time tuning things in the BIOS. However, moving on to the BIOS, this is where this motherboard employs that simple formula from ASRock where they haven't really changed the BIOS in a couple of years, but they don't need to because it's got everything that you would need from a BIOS. It's lightweight, you can maneuver in it very quickly, you can lock in overclocks on RAM and CPU very quickly, save up to 10 different profiles, and then do other things like tune each of the individual fan headers to custom profiles. And then on top of that, you can, and this is one of my favorite things about ASRock boards, control RGB from the BIOS itself, meaning you don't have to install any bloatware in Windows and potentially losing some performance, whether it's in games or productivity. Now you do have two RGB headers up the top, one of those being a 3-pin 5-volt, the other being a 4-pin 12-volt. Then down the bottom, you also share that same formula. So you've got two of each, one up the top, one down the bottom. And so far, so good for the X570S Riptide, but here's where things surprisingly get better, especially at this price point where you've got 6 PWM fan headers. You also got two USB 3 outs, as well as a 3.2 Type-C to make 5 USB 3 outs in total, as well as an additional two USB 2.0 connectors. So you potentially have an additional 9 USB front out headers if you wish to. Then you've got 8 USB ports at the back, 4 of those being 3.2 with one of those being a Type-C and the rest Type-A. Then you've got two 3.1, as well as two USB 2s and a 2.5 gigabit LAN solution from Realtek, as well as a PS2 port and a HDMI out, and the option to add an M.2 Wi-Fi if you wish to, as well as a BIOS flashback button, and then 7.1 audio with the optical out. Now speaking of the USB 3 speeds as well as the NIC speeds, they were both fine in my testing, and then onto the audio testing, actually showed one thing that I haven't seen in a long time, and that's the Realtek audio on board that works flawlessly, at least in Windows 11, because usually in the past I was testing with volume levels of 91 and over, I used to see the crosstalk leak, but it seems like ASRock have fixed this on the X570S Riptide, where you can turn the volume all the way up to 100 and the crosstalk is going to be absolutely fine, as well as the crosstalk numbers themselves being minus 88 decibels. And this, of course, is being some pretty impressive numbers when we look at that in contrast to the frequency response numbers, which were also really impressive too, where we had a minus 1.3 decibel drop off from 20 hertz and under. So you're not really going to lose any of those sub bass frequencies. But then from 20 hertz to 2K was pretty much perfectly flat, and zooming into the frequency response curves, it had extremely low jitter, which essentially means very low distortion. But after 2K, here's where things actually got interesting for the audio response, where 2K to 10K had a drop off of roughly 1 decibel, and this is basically essentially gonna make the sound warmer. So in other words, this frequency response is gonna be a little bit colored, and that's gonna be a little bit warmer. And personally, I like this, but some people might want a pure flat response curve. So that's one thing I will point out. But then going on to the audio, the mic input, that worked absolutely fine, although it did have heavy noise suppression, so it won't be good for professional recordings, but it will be good if you want to play games with your mates and they be able to hear you clearly on pretty much any cheap microphone. And there it all is with the numbers, and basically it's time to give you guys a conclusion, especially based around the price point of $180. And all I have to say is if you're looking for a board that pretty much is solid in all different areas, then this board is going to be it. Of course, I would like to see things like power buttons added on, as well as included Wi-Fi. However, especially when we contrast that to the 8-layer PCB, the impressive VRM performance, and the impressive onboard audio performance, as well as the feature set, especially with all those additional USB ports, I have to say that this board is simply a winner in that regard. It's got everything that I would want from a motherboard personally, especially at the price point. I think it's a very solid board if you're looking to get on the X570 line and not have a chipset heatsink fan as well, where traditionally when they released the X570 motherboards, it was only like the $1,000 motherboards that had no chipset heatsink fans, but they also had pretty much a motherboard heatsink that would encompass the whole motherboard itself, both front and back. So this coming in at its price point with the performance, I thought was actually a very pleasant surprise, but more importantly, I'm looking to see ASRock continue the Riptide formula for other upcoming potential future releases with motherboards. I think what they've got here is an absolute winning formula, not just in looks, but also performance. And it's a breath of fresh air to see ASRock releasing a very solid board to the market. However, that being said, I will say X570 has already been out for quite some time, so how much life it does have left, I don't really know just yet. And with that aside, I hope you guys enjoyed today's video. If you did, then be sure to hit that like button. Also, let us know in the comments section below what you think of these X570 refresh motherboards. Do you think they were a needed breath of fresh air, or do you want to see something different in the tech space? Love reading your thoughts and opinions. As always, just like this question of the day here, which comes from Owen Mitchell, and they ask, is it safe to buy X mining cards? I've always been told to stay away from them because they're generally thrashed to hell. And here's where it depends. And that's pretty much the simple answer is, if you're going to buy a mining card, go look at the condition that it's in. Personally, all the X mining cards that I've bought, I've always been able to inspect them physically. And if they're too far gone, especially when it comes to having rust on the heatsink and perhaps even on things like resistors and transistors, then I generally tend to stay away from those cards. As opposed to, say, a recent deal that I got on RX570s, I could visibly inspect those cards and I was like, wow, these haven't been mined on a whole lot. So you can pick up really good deals from X mining cards, but the simplest piece of advice would be to inspect the card. And if you can especially see it working as well and see how much headroom it has in the overclocks, then that can be another great indicator too. But if you're buying them online and you haven't inspected them, then I would try to definitely get some kind of guarantee that it'll work for at least 3 months or something like that. So if it does fail, you can get your money back. Anyhow, guys, I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. If you stayed this far and you're enjoying that Tech Yes content, be sure to hit that sub button, ring that bell, and I'll see you in the next one. Peace out for now. Bye.